¿Qué te pareció la pelea de Gennady Golovkin y Lemieux?
¿Te sorprendió que usó Golovkin más? Porque dicen que es el estilo mexicano, pero usó un poquito más el boxeo. ¿Te sorprendió un poco eso?
No, yo sé que Golovkin puede hacerlo. Como lo he hecho mucho sparring con él tiempo atrás. Tenía 20 años cuando lo hice.
Canelo walks into the gym. Did you know who he was at all?
Él y yo podíamos tirar fuerte porque a muchos sparring no puede uno tirar fuerte o tirar todo tu potencia.
No, I know him. Who is it? A big prospect from Golden Boy.
Él y yo podíamos hacerlo y era un campeón mundial medio con un campeón mundial super welter.
How do you think he has changed or improved as a fighter?
Not big change.
Really?
No, not big change.
Hicimos una muy buena amistad también y recuerdo buenas cosas.
He's two different people. He pretends to be a nice guy, but he's no. He's an asshole.
It began with an innocuous sparring session in 2011. Back then, Saul Canelo Alvarez was a 21-year-old prospect, still overshadowed by Julio Cesar Chavez Jr., the man being pushed as the next Mexican attraction. Gennady Golovkin, then a 20-0 prospect, was an unknown Kazakh fighter that would soon terrorize the middleweight division. Since then, both men have had their ups and their downs. Along the way, they've battled each other twice, with both bouts raising more questions than answers. Now, boxing's lucky number three is just around the corner.
Do you feel this time that you can knock him out?
Yeah, I don't feel it. I'm gonna do it.
For the 40-year-old Golovkin, once the most feared boxer on the planet, the Canelo fight is the proving ground for his ongoing comeback and a chance to finally score an official victory over his nemesis. As for Saul Canelo Alvarez, once the best pound-for-pound fighter on the planet, the Golovkin fight represents the perfect path for regaining his crown and to shut his rival once and for all. With these factors at play, the prospects for an explosive finale look pretty gosh darn good. The path to stardom proved difficult for both men. For Gennady Golovkin, fighting in the streets of Kazakhstan since he was a kid set the foundation for a style that would represent total destruction. After being robbed of a gold medal in the 2004 Olympics and having accomplished everything in his ranks, Golovkin turned pro in 2006. Power was evident as he scored stoppage after stoppage. But it was in 2011, after languishing in limbo, that Golovkin escaped the clutches of his promoter. He moved his training camp to the United States, where he hired veteran trainer Abel Sanchez. The man would take what was essentially a long-range boxer, turned him into a pressure fighter. With his proficient footwork, Golovkin employed a suffocating style that allowed him to deliver his bombs. One after another, top contenders fell before him, often within the first four rounds. Even the strong contender Martin Murray, who'd gone the distance against then-lineal middleweight champion Sergio Martinez, failed to hear the final bell, getting stopped in the 11th round. His badge of honor at the time was to have made it the farthest anyone had against Golovkin, but he'd been forced to absorb a frightful beating to get there. When Golovkin faced the hardest puncher of his career, David Lemieux, he showed that he was more than just a power puncher, as he outboxed and broke down the explosive Canadian. His first time going all 12 rounds came when he fought Daniel Jacobs, a quick-fisted American who outweighed him on fight night by more than 10 pounds. By then, Golovkin carried the mantle of boogeyman, the man no one wanted to face. As for Canelo Alvarez, who turned pro at 15 years of age, his development came in increments, beating smaller, older fighters and French contenders.
Good right hand by Canelo, up and under, and then a big right cross across the top. Gomez is badly hurt. Nice.
But it was in 2013, when Canelo finally stepped up, he'd been eyeing the great Miguel Cotto as a potential opponent. The Puerto Rican had built momentum by giving Floyd Mayweather one of his most demanding fights. But Cotto soon ran into an upset defeat at the hands of the undefeated Austin Trout. Trout was a solid 154-pounder whose southpaw style baffled opponents. On top of the Cotto win, Trout had also beaten Canelo's older brother, Rigoberto. Canelo displayed nifty head movement and a two-fisted attack to do what the more experienced Cotto had failed to do. That same year, the 23-year-old Canelo stepped up against one of the top two fighters in the world, Floyd Mayweather Jr., in a bout that proved too much too soon for the young Mexican. However, Canelo walked out of the bout unscathed and with more exposure than ever. He embarked on a comeback trail, beating all manner of styles. Along the way, his public profile continued growing. In 2015, he fought the aforementioned Cotto, who was enjoying a career renaissance after dethroning middleweight king Sergio Martinez. Canelo finally proved that he was a pound-for-pound talent by outboxing his more experienced foe. By 2016, no fan or media member could mention Canelo's name without having to mention Golovkin's.
I mean, you have two tough guys, two real strong guys. Both guys can punch very well. I'd like to see that fight.
I mean, I don't think it's going to happen. I think it's just talk about it to, you know, to keep everything relative and to keep you guys satisfied.
I know Golovkin very well. He's a friend of mine. And like I said before, and I'll say it again, I have respect for him, but I'm not afraid of anybody.
Make against Triple G and Canelo if they both win?
Oh, absolutely, because A, you heard it and I heard it. Both of them said he can do it. Both of them said he will do it. It makes sense.
When you look at both guys fight, Golovkin would seem to be the most dangerous fighter by far.
I respect him. Of course. He's a great champion. He's a good guy.
Wanting to see how you do against a guy like this and want to compare it to how Gennady Golovkin did to similar competition. Is there a part of you that wants to prove to him and to everybody else that you could do a lot better?
He's the one that needs to worry about how he looks and compare himself to me. I don't have to worry about that, and I don't worry about that.
I'm saying, if you really want to fight, forget all that catchweight crap. Let's go. You got the title at 160. Let's fight. If you don't want to fight, then say, I'm not ready yet. Give him a couple more years. Then we'll do that 160. But forget all this 157.
I'm glad you brought that up.
I don't know if Canelo could knock out a Rosado. I don't know if a Canelo could knock out a Martin Murray or, you know, a Mule.
Would it happen immediately? Well, it would happen that year. And that year would be 2016.
But the year went by with Canelo taking an interim fight and then ditching the WBC belt. The act delayed the negotiations with Golovkin and stalled the much-anticipated bout.
There's a guy ringside watching this fight tonight who comes to attack Triple G.
Yo lo invité a que subiera.
I invited him to come to the ring.
Como decimos en México, hay que dejarnos de mamadas.
I invited him to the ring, and like we say in Mexico, we don't fuck around. We don't fight for rings and stuff like that.
Now it's time for him to take the risk and quit hiding behind little stuff, okay? See, set the tone. Amir set the tone. Fighters should fight each other. He got to quit hiding behind the flag and fight Triple G.
Triple G is setting him up, and if he's still on that rope.
Body shot, Brooke is in trouble.
That's some sure. See the guy stand there and trade with Gennady Golovkin and God knows how long, right? And Dominic in the far corner is holding up a towel. Engel is trying to get referee Marlon Wright to stop the fight, and now he finally throws the towel into the ring.
Knockout number 23 in a row.
Would you still want to fight Canelo with everything that's gone on?
Absolutely, I am open for everybody.
Obligatory Triple G question. After your last fight, I asked you about him. You said, I don't mess around. I'm paraphrasing.
Yo no le tengo miedo a nadie.
You know, I fear no one.
To some, looks like you're ducking Triple G as though you're taking a bullet for your promoter.
We're a team. We are a team. And I'm not going to blame my promoter or anyone else.
But it was in 2017, after beating the by then unworthy Julio Cesar Chavez Jr., that Canelo called Golovkin fourth.
Golovkin, you are next, my friend.
I see the timepiece moving on. That there will be a fight between you two in September of this year?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I feel very excited. Guys, right now it's a different story. In September, it's big Mexican style, you know, big drama show. Good luck in September.
La suerte es para los mediocres, my friend.
luck is for the mediocre people.
Timepiece moving with those hands.
So there was a tremendous amount of angst among hardcore fans, and there was a tremendous amount of pressure from the Mexican sports media and the US boxing media at every turn. And it wasn't just before and after a Canelo event, it was at every Golden Boy event.
I picked Canelo. I picked the redhead. I think that he got better boxing skills, and I think that Danny Jacobs kind of gave him a blueprint.
But I lean toward Golovkin. I think he's going to score a late knockout, if you want me to be very specific.
Some people say Golovkin's too slow. Is that?
He is too slow.
I like Triple G in the fight, but he might be slipping a little bit. He didn't look that great in his last fight, but it was the first time he fought a real slick boxer.
Andy Golovkin is a very hard man to defeat, but I'm going for Canelo Alvarez to box brilliantly.
Canelo have a decent power that he can get his attention.
Right.
You gotta respect.
You talk about who's fought the better middleweights.
It's Golovkin. Yeah, of course.
Canelo hasn't fought any.
I think Canelo can do it if he fight the right fight.
You know, this is the first time he fighting somebody his size. I don't think he's going to be able to do all that fighting spurts like he do. I think Triple G going to push the pace and make him fight, maybe even stop Canelo.
It's hard to be on your bicycle for a long time. And one of the best attributes of Triple G is he cuts off the ring as good as anybody ever has in that division.
I think Canelo can outbox him, but at the same time, Canelo's going to have to deal with that pressure and deal with those, modern-day hands of stone.
Does Golovkin hit Canelo with the jab consistently? Because as you said, we've all said it, his upper body movement is very, very overlooked.
I like Canelo in the fight. Canelo's learned a lot. He's been in there with the best. He's come a long ways. His boxing skills, I think, have elevated since he fought Floyd.
Canelo would be Triple G. That was just getting outboxed by a welterweight, if I'm not mistaken. I know boxing. This is what I do. Nobody in the world knows boxing like me. The experience proves it and everything else proves it.
Canelo beats Triple G, Floyd Mayweather says, all right?
Canelo knocks Triple G out.
Whoa!
T-Mobile Arena, Las Vegas, by way of the MGM Grand.
The much-anticipated bout proved to be anticlimactic, as Canelo, after a fast start, spent much of his time retreating. Golovkin, meanwhile, had trouble landing his power shots and was content to pile up points with his laser jab. The decision only served to further mar the event.
This is officially a draw.
Many fans and media members agreed that Golovkin should have received the decision. But Canelo and his mother disagreed.
But I won 7-8 rounds quite easily.
Porque la pelea la ganó mi hijo. Clarita.
The majority of the ire was directed at Judge Adelaide Bird, who submitted the ludicrous score of 118-110 for Canelo, meaning she only gave Golovkin 2 rounds. Don Trella's scorecard, although less ludicrous, was nevertheless open to criticism, as he submitted the tied scorecard. The logical move was for a rematch in 2018, but things soon went awry when Canelo tested positive for a banned substance. He was subsequently suspended for 6 months. Still wishing to remain active, Golovkin fought a last-minute replacement in the form of former contender Vanis Martirosyan. The Kazakh disposed of him in 2 rounds, becoming the first man to halt the tough contender. After being suspended, Canelo waited out the year and signed on to fight Golovkin in September. By then, Canelo, still maintaining his innocence, became enraged by Team Golovkin.
You can't punch somebody when you're running. And Canelo was running, so it's hard for Golovkin to throw his punches when the other guy's running. Because I think that the fans are fed up with all the BS, and the fans want to see a fight.
Circunstancias en la pelea, no ir solo para adelante tirando golpes. Eso es boxear, ¿no? Y me extraña de él que dice que se cree un gran entrenador, que no sepa lo que distinguir que es tener técnica con lo otro que
dice. I'd like to respond by saying there's some guys out there to tell him to quit running, and that's exactly what he did the first fight. The first fight is not one that he can sell too many times and lie to these people like he did the first time.
Primero que nada quiero decir, también mentiste a tus fans. Dijiste que me ibas a noquear en 6 rounds.
It's impossible to knock somebody out when he fights the fight not to be knocked out.
Y te hablo a ti porque tu peleador no dice nada. Eres el que más abre el hocico.
Okay, upcoming fight.
Triple G, if he go to the body, I already know what you're going to ask me.
Okay.
If Canelo box him and stay off the ropes, may get the decision.
I like Canelo. I like his skills. I like his ring IQ. You know, he's very versatile, but I'm going with Canelo.
Triple G.
Oh, I got Canelo. I thought he won the first time by round.
If I ever get able to pay this debt I owe, it's going down.
Now in a genuine grudge match, the fight produced the fireworks expected for the first bout. Canelo, angered by the accusations of being a runner and a cheater, stood his ground. Golovkin used his jab as much as possible, while Canelo attempted to work the body, trying his darnest to turn the tables on the big puncher.
Gennady, you see it's red and here's a nice red. And who's on the uppercut?
In the 10th, Golovkin struck first, stunning Canelo. The Mexican recuperated, and he continued trying to back Triple G up. In the end, Canelo walked away with a majority decision. Although a much closer fight than the first, many fans and media members still felt that Golovkin had done enough to win. And once again, the compy box numbers displayed it. Still, Canelo had fulfilled his promise of standing his ground, and he'd managed to go to war with a murderous puncher. Canelo skirted talk of a third bout, content with having walked away with an official victory. One has to assume that all the trash talking from Golovkin's team had soured his mood. Canelo carried his momentum by beating the next best contender, Daniel Jacobs. Then, in an unprecedented move, he jumped to the light heavyweight division and dethroned power-punching Sergey Kovalev. Golovkin, meanwhile, parted ways with Abel Sanchez over compensation issues. The Kazakh then employed Jonathan Banks, a former professional boxer and trainer of long-reigning heavyweight champion Vladimir Klitschko. The hope was that he would add new wrinkles to Golovkin's game. The Kazakh stopped the Canadian Steve Rolls in the third round and then signed on to fight the tough Sergey Davidachenko. The Ukrainian was a strong, bullish fighter that had given Daniel Jacobs all he could handle a few years earlier. As usual, Golovkin started with a bang, dropping Davidachenko within the first three rounds. It seemed like it would be a short night, but the Ukrainian adapted Triple G's power and began to connect. To make matters worse, Golovkin's breathing appeared labored, and he seemed on the verge of gassing out. In the sixth, Davidachenko visually hurt Golovkin for the first time in his career and continued firing a fusillade of shots. Golovkin continued landing his bombs, and Davidachenko's face became a mask of lumps. In the 10th, Golovkin landed more bombs, but the referee prematurely halted the round.
Ref, what the fuck are you doing?
The last two rounds saw more back and forth action. The fight had been extremely close, and Golovkin pulled it off with a score of 114-113 and two cards of 115-112. Compy box numbers showed Golovkin had outlanded Davidachenko, but there was no doubt that Golovkin had looked shaky. Now, people began to wonder if At the age of 37, Golovkin was finally done. In the wake of his light heavyweight win, Canelo entered 2020 riding high as the best pound-for-pound fighter in the world. He dropped a division, moving to 168, and decisioned the undefeated Callum Smith in a one-sided affair. Golovkin, meanwhile, faced the undefeated but unheralded Camille Zedemeta. Although his opponent was subpar, Golovkin demonstrated more upper body movement and had an easy time in making Zedemeta quit after the eighth round.
And the referee has waved it off, ladies and gentlemen. He has stopped it. History made as Triple G, Gennady Golovkin, defends the middleweight title for the 21st time, passing the legendary Bernard Hopkins.
In 2021, Canelo was determined to gather all the super middleweight straps. After dispatching of the unworthy Avni Yildirim, Canelo signed on to fight Billy Joe Saunders for more of the belts. Saunders was an elusive southpaw, and he wasted a little time in getting under Canelo's skin.
What's it like facing defeat, young man, in your life?
Mm-hmm. What's happening with the ring, man? Come on, is this fight happening or not?
You're the gypsy.
The gypsy. We've come a long way. Grow some. Grow some bollocks, man. Come on.
The gypsy.
Mexican is
right. The Mexican.
We know.
You had loads of beef.
Yeah.
You love the beef. You
are a fucking pussy.
Pussy! You've not seen anybody with this arm.
Thank you. I'll box you, man. I'll push you up.
Walk away. Walk away.
On fight night, Canelo pressured his foe while remaining defensively responsible. Unaccustomed to being controlled, Saunders did his best to offset Canelo with his movement. He began to have some success in the middle rounds, connecting with some of his best shots. Then, Canelo walked him into an uppercut, shattering his orbital bone. The fight was effectively over. The remaining belt was held by the undefeated Caleb Plant, a tall and elusive fighter with plenty of confidence. Still, in his best two wins, Plant had displayed vulnerability. Against Jose Uzcategui, Plant had managed to drop him twice before encountering Rocky Waters and a scrapped-off face to win his title. For many, Canelo would be too experienced, too strong, and too good for Plant. But then, what was seen as a predictable fight turned hot after a press conference coffee. Now, Plant's jawing appeared to carry some merit, and some fans began to give him a chance to win. Plant proved himself a capable fighter, using his footwork to try and offset Canelo while firing plenty of jabs. As the fight progressed, however, Canelo closed the gap, seemingly unconcerned by Plant's power. Then, in the 11th, he struck with a bump. Two fighters showed each other respect, and Canelo continued the momentum as the best pound-for-pound fighter in the world. Golovkin, meanwhile, languished in 2021, as his lone scheduled fight was delayed by more COVID restrictions in Japan. Luckily for him, he was back in early 2022, and he prepared to take on the undefeated Ryota Murata. Having earned a gold medal in the 2012 Olympics, Murata was a big middleweight with power to rival Golovkin's. Murata had also overcome adversity by avenging his two losses, one of which had been a total robbery against Azan and Dam. In the rematches, Murata proved too vicious as he trampled his foes.
reminds me of the days when my future was bright. Nowadays it looks stomped like Shook Knight. Right when I feel what I feel.
Seeing Miranda's performances, many began to doubt whether a 40-year-old Golovkin would manage a victory, especially after his harrowing war against Davidchenko. Much was at stake for Golovkin, as Canelo had signed a two-fight contract with the streaming platform DAZN. And one of his fights would include the much-anticipated rubber match with Golovkin. Kazakh stood right in front of Moreira, launching heavy shots at his opponent's guard. Moreira began targeting the body, and again, Golovkin's breathing appeared labored. Golovkin would shoot monstrous flurries. But would then spend long stretches without landing much. Still, he says in the hole remained his jab. Then, the tide began to turn. Golovkin's superhuman power began to take its toll on the Japanese fighter, and his body wilted. Moreira remained game, throwing with abandon. But the fight was starting to look like a vintage Golovkin trousing. Never happy, I'm a sad, pathetic, claustrophobic. You a metalhead, I cut it off and rock and roll it. It's a strong urge and I cannot control it. It's like I'm possessed to some shit. Too much consumption. Finally, Moreira fell, and his corner threw in the towel. Although the start had been shaky, Golovkin showed that his power remained a feared asset, and he'd shown that, even at 40 years of age, he could break apart younger fighters. In 2022, Canelo planned another risky move to 175 pounds. And so, the Mexican signed on to fight light heavyweight title holder Dmitry Bivol. Although unknown by the casual fan, the undefeated Russian was a quick foe with a polished amateur pedigree and respectable opposition in the professional ranks. Still, Canelo was confident that he could handle his speed after having beaten quicksters like Saunders and Plant. Moreover, he'd already beaten one of the best light heavyweights in Sergey Kovalev. The problem was that Bivol was a much fresher fighter than Kovalev, and he'd never shown the stamina issues that Canelo had exploited against his fellow Russian. The first three rounds appeared even, with both men studying each other. Canelo then began to bank Bivol onto the ropes. But contrary to the Smith and Plant fights, Canelo's single shots failed to inflict the damage intended. To make matters worse, Canelo began to tire, and Bivol remained as active as ever. Canelo then tried to draw Bivol in, but the Russian proved too quick for the Mexican's counters. Realizing his plight, Canelo tried to walk Bivol down, but his attack was limited by his faulty stamina. It appeared as if Canelo had fallen in love with his approach of launching single shots, which proved costly against a bigger man that could absorb them. Moreover, Bivol's in-and-out style nullified Canelo's counterpunching. In the end, Bivol walked away with a decision, and Canelo's mantle of invincibility was removed.
His behavior now shows that he's not confident, but I don't think about it. He's not on my mind.
What is it about him that you just don't like?
He's always talking about me. He's always talking shit about me.
Why is it that Canelo's taking it more personal?
He pretends to be a nice guy, but he's no. He's an asshole. That's why he is.
Perhaps he needs it. He needs to motivate himself after his loss.
What can I say now? That he's just, a red mouse?
Now, the Mexican finds himself at a crossroads, with extra motivation to defeat his career nemesis, and all hopes of a Bivol rematch hinge on a future victory. Meanwhile, Golovkin figures this to be the last shot he'll ever have at a pound-for-pound megafight, and the last chance to finally beat his nemesis. Will the third fight live up to the conclusive bouts of past rivalries? Let us know in the comment section below. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and we will see you on the next one. Take it easy, folks. Thanks for watching.